All the participants, today's session is on introduction to mobile security, and I've already introduced myself yesterday. I'm Yash Dhingra, scientist in the Indian Computer Emergency Response Team, which is a part of Ministry of Electronics and IT. And we are going to look at some basics of mobile security and some best practices about what all the security best practices we can take in order to make sure that we have our devices are not compromised. And after that, we are going to look at some case studies which Certin has been looking at, so that you can get an idea about how mobile devices can actually be hacked, and then they can actually be used for even more large scale attacks. So let us begin. So again, just like yesterday, we are going to talk about some current trends in the mobile security space, and with that, you will probably be able to relate to some of these incidents, because it's possible some of these incidents might have actually happened with you. And we are going to look at these things, current trends. So starting with the fake Arogya Setu applications, I think we already discussed it in the session yesterday about the fake Arogya Setu applications, which were used for spying on Indian government officials. And then you might have heard about this news regarding the government blocking various applications of various different applications which were suspected of being prejudicial to the security of the country. So initially 59 applications were blocked in June, and next after that I think 47 applications, which were basically alternates or clones of the original applications, were blocked I think in July or August. And then again 118 more applications were blocked in September, and then another wave of 48 applications was blocked I think November end or somewhere around November, I guess, yeah. So it's a huge list of applications, somewhere around 200 to 250, somewhere between that. And we have blocked all these applications because they were taking a lot of data of Indian consumers, and then all that data was actually going to servers which were located in hostile countries. So that was one of the reasons. And then there were some other applications which were suspicious practices. I think we talked about TikTok yesterday also in the session. So TikTok was involved in harvesting of user data, including MAC addresses, which is basically not allowed. And then TikTok was also one of the applications which was blocked. So nowadays, I haven't put the slides of that, but nowadays you might have heard of this new trend for loan applications, which has been going on for some time. And these loan applications have been going around on WhatsApp. So the user will get a message that if you want a loan, then you can apply for a loan like that. And then once the user applies for a loan, they also actually give the loan to the user, although a very less amount. And then later in like 10 or 15 days, whenever the time period of the loan expires, then they start calling up the user and the various different contacts. So that is also in the current trends, although the screenshots are not there in this presentation. So Android permission overview. So just looking at these, we are going to look at these permissions. I'm pretty sure you've installed some applications on your device from the Google Play Store or from the Apple App Store. And you must have come across this particular page where it gives you the list of all the permissions that the application needs in order to execute its functionality. So this is actually a screenshot from a previous version of Android, I think Android 5 or 6. So earlier what used to happen was that all the permissions that the application seeks were actually shown to the user at the time of installation itself. So you can see that this particular screenshot, it is showing the permissions for reading the messages and for your personal information, including calendar events and all those things. So I think after Android 6 or 7, this thing has changed. And now Android actually doesn't show you the permissions to these particular things like SMS and personal information in, at the install time itself, because you need to give these permissions while you are using the application. So we are going to look at different kinds of permissions and why some of these permissions are actually shown while you are trying to install the app, and why some of these permissions are actually shown while you are actually using the application. So let us first look at the normal permissions. So normal permissions are basically those permissions which do not require access to any of your personal information. So for example, if you want to, if the app wants to connect to the internet, then that is not, there is no personal information about the user which is involved in this particular permission. So that is categorized as a normal permission. And then accessing the time zone or maybe, you know, accessing the your mobile, accessing your mobile data. So all these permissions are very simple permissions where your personal data is not involved. So these permissions are categorized as normal permissions. And these permissions are the ones which are shown at the install time nowadays in Android. So while you're installing the application, you will see a prompt which will ask you that the app wants to connect to the internet and all the other normal permissions. And then you need to grant those permissions to install the application. Because if you do not want to grant a particular permission like this to the application, then you simply need to click the cancel button. You cannot install it. So once you have given this permission, basically once you have installed this application, then these permissions actually cannot be revoked, which means you cannot take back the permission once you have given it. You will have to actually uninstall the application altogether to take back these permissions from the app. So these are normal permissions. And then moving on to signature permissions. So signature permissions are basically not defined by Android. So whatever permissions we are talking about in this particular presentation, all the permissions are actually defined by the Android OS itself. And these signature permissions are actually proprietary, which means that an app actually declares this particular permission. So the app developer actually can define certain proprietary permissions, which then can actually be used for communication between two applications of the same developer. So as an example, if you have two apps from the same developer, for example, Facebook and Instagram, and now we are hearing that even WhatsApp is going the same way. So if Facebook and Instagram want to share some data, then the Facebook application will declare a signature permission inside itself, which will allow Instagram to actually access the data inside the Facebook app. So that is what signature permissions are basically used for, basically to allow two applications of the same developer to talk to each other. So the catch here is that the same certificate should be used for signing both the applications, which means the developer of the applications should be same. So these are signature permissions. Again, these permissions are actually needed to be granted at the install time, just like the normal permissions. So then there are dangerous permissions. These are actually the permissions in which the user's personal data is involved, and some of your private information would information would be required if you are giving this particular permission to the application. So some of these permissions are like reading your contacts, getting your location, getting your call history, getting your mobile number from your device. So all these permissions are basically categorized as dangerous permissions. And the reason why these are actually categorized as dangerous, because these are the only permissions which can actually be misused to get hold of some information of the user. So that is why these particular permissions are actually granted at runtime. So when you're when you first time you open the app and you're trying to use a particular feature of the application, at that time the application will actually ask you for permission to access that feature. So if you've used these social media applications like Facebook and Instagram and all, you might have seen that when you open the application and when you try to open the camera feature for the first time, that is when the application will actually request you for permission to access the camera. So that is also one of the dangerous permissions. So all these permissions, the thing about them is how they are differentiated from normal permissions is that they can actually be revoked. So you can grant this particular permission to the application, but then you can take this permission back also. You can simply go into the settings page, find out the application list, and then you can go inside each application and look at what permissions you have already granted. And then all the dangerous permissions would be listed, and you can actually untick that option, and that permission will be revoked. So the app will not be able to use that particular permission, that particular feature after that. And the last kind of permissions are called special permissions. So these permissions are actually even more sensitive than the previous ones. And one of these permissions is the right settings permissions. So when you are granting this particular permission to an application, you are basically giving it the permission to even change the settings of the device. So that can be a big security issue. That's why these permissions are also granted at runtime, and you need to go specifically inside the settings page, and then inside the settings page you will actually have to go and enable this particular permission. Explicitly, then this particular permission will be given to the application. So normally any application will not require this particular permission of right settings. Only certain type of applications will require this. And if you're getting any application which ideally should not be asking for this permission, but it is still seeking this permission, then that is like a red flag. So these permissions can also be revoked, just like the dangerous permissions. So we have talked about the permissions, but we need to look at some best practices about what we need to make sure while we are trying to install applications, and how we need to make sure that we are not giving any wrong permissions to an app which does not normally require it. So the first thing is we should always check the permissions before installing an application. So the OS will give you a dialog box which will tell you what all permission it is requiring. But on the page itself, on the application page itself, on both App Store and Google Play Store, you see that there is an option to actually check all the permissions which the application would be requiring. So you can just go and go through that list of permissions that the app might be taking, and then you can decide accordingly whether you want to install the application or not. So, if a web browser is asking for permission to access your camera or microphone directly, even if you're not using that feature, then this is like a red flag. So, I'm pretty sure you might have heard of this browser called UC Browser. It used to come pre-installed with a lot of mobile manufacturers' devices. And this particular application was actually one of the applications which was blocked by the government. So UC Browser actually used to take all the permissions from the user, including camera, microphone, location, call history, and everything, and even the contacts, I think, which obviously a browser ideally should not need. So they were actually very oversmart in their tactics, and they used to sell a lot of features where they would ask for these permissions, although or ideally a web browser should not be asking for these permissions. So that was always a red flag, and you should always take care that if you're installing any application and that application is asking for a lot of permissions, which ideally it should not require based on its functionality. So such applications you should always stay away from and simply uninstall them from your device. So then it is really important to check the permissions which you have already granted to application. So just go into your settings page inside the applications list and just check what all permissions you have already given to all the application. Just make sure that your contacts, your location history, your call logs, and other such your SMSs and other such important permissions are not being granted to any random application. These permissions should be granted only to specific applications which actually require it. So you might have actually heard about these UPI applications, so Bheem and Google Pay and other applications. So all these applications will actually need some extra permissions than what you might think they require. For example, they normally require the access to your phone because they need to verify if you're using the same SIM card which you have declared in the while you have registered. So some of these applications might actually require more permissions, but otherwise, normally, just by looking at the functionality, you will be able to guess whether the permission which is asked by the device is actually correct or it is required or not. Moving on, some best practices and things to keep in mind. We need to always keep our operating systems updated. This is something that we saw yesterday as well. We need to update our applications also. Android will keep telling you that so and so applications need to be updated, and similarly iOS also keeps prompting you to install updates. So always keep your applications and operating system updated, and only install what you absolutely need. So there is a chance that since these mobile applications are actually free to use, most of us actually tend to hoard a lot of applications on our device. You just saw an application which you thought was good, or someone sent you a link to a particular application, and you simply installed it, but you are not using it any time. So that is not a good practice. You should not hoard applications on your device. Even though nowadays most devices have enough storage, but it's always a good practice to uninstall unused applications from your phone. If you have not been using any application for the past 1 month or 2 months, then it's always a good practice to actually simply uninstall that device. Uninstall the application from your device. Then there are a lot of over-smart applications which are being sold, which are being actually marketed as memory cleaners or battery optimizers, and some of these actually come bundled with a lot of Chinese OEM devices. So these memory cleaners and battery optimizers and other such applications are actually of no use for the device. In fact, they cause more harm than actually they do any good. They will take a lot of permissions from you. And then what happens is that they try to clear the memory, and then they obviously have access to even your storage, and then they can read your data also. So they can be a big potential risk on your device instead of being of any use. So always uninstall these applications if they are pre-installed on your device also, and never install such applications. Then some other best practices: you should always use antivirus on your device, which is recommended for any device that you are using, and you should not install application from untrusted sources. I'm sure most of you would have gone through the settings page, and there is an option inside Android which says that which actually asks you for permission to enable installation from untrusted sources, which means you can simply download an APK file from the internet and install it on your device instead of going to the Play Store. So always keep that thing, the option, unchecked, which means you should not allow installation from untrusted sources. If you're getting any APK file from somewhere, it could actually be a virus, and it could actually take a lot, basically make your own mobile phone a spying device, and then it might start recording your conversations, or it might just start taking your SMSs. So always stay away from these APK files. On the iOS side, this is not an issue because you cannot actually install applications from outside the App Store. unless if you jailbreak the device, which is never recommended, because then you are compromising the security of the device entirely. Then check which apps have permissions to access the location, contacts, and actually your SMSs also, that should also be included in this. So all this, your call logs, your contacts, your SMSs, your location, all these are really, really important. And in fact, apart from the basic messaging and basic phone applications, none of the applications should actually have access to these permissions. Then moving on, Truecaller, UC Browser, Cam Scanner. UC Browser I have already talked about. Cam Scanner was one of the applications which were also blocked by the government in 2020. And Cam Scanner was actually involved in a controversy wherein it was actually taken down from the Google Play Store also for some time, I think 2020 or 2019. I don't remember the exact month when it happened. But it was, I think, a little more than a year ago. And Cam Scanner was actually flagged because there was a particular advertising API or a advertising module which Cam Scanner was using. And that particular module was actually malicious, which means it was a third party software, and there was some problem on the company which was supplying that particular module for advertising, and there was a virus inside that which could actually start spying on the user. So Cam Scanner was actually flagged by a lot of antiviruses at that particular time, and then it was taken down from the Google Play Store for some time, until it had actually rectified the problem, and then it actually came back on the Play Store. Eventually, it was blocked by the government. So such applications, that is the main reason why I have recommended in the previous slides that you should not keep unused applications on your device, because then those applications become an unnecessary security risk for you. It is possible that some of those applications may not directly be malicious, but they might be having some malicious module embedded inside them, which you may never get to know of. And if you're using a particular application, then it's okay, at least you're using it, but an unused application becomes an unintentional security risk. So they should always be removed. Then Truecaller, I think most of the users would be having this particular application on their devices. In fact, just yesterday, I think I read an article from the CEO of this company who was saying that they actually have more than 50% market share in the Indian market, which means their application is actually installed on more than 50% smartphones which are currently live in India, which is a huge, huge number. And if you think about it, Truecaller actually takes access to your contacts, it takes access to your to your call logs, to your call history, and I think even your location as well, if I'm not wrong. Nowadays, they've also started this new payment system as well. So they are taking a lot of permissions from the users. And if you think about it, if a particular application is actually installed on 50% of the Indian smartphone space, then total number would be like in millions of devices. So what happens if, like Truecaller, we can, for example, if we assume that Truecaller is a benign company, if the company is well intentioned, what happens if actually there is a cybersecurity breach on Truecaller, and there is an attacker who actually compromises the data of Truecaller? So that is the main thing that we are worried about, and that has actually happened previously. So this is a report from May 2019. Wherein it was revealed that 300 million records of Truecaller users were leaked, and the only problem was that Truecaller actually denied this particular leak, although there were like several screenshots and several such snippets of data which were available. If you can just read the names, you'll see they are names of Indian users, and inside the image column, which is the fourth column, you'll be able to see that the link mentions Truecaller somewhere. So it's possible that this data actually belonged to Truecaller, although Truecaller actually denying this particular claim that they ever suffered an attack. So then again in May 2020 also, which is almost exactly 1 year after the previous attack, there was another report of an attack on Truecaller, and then 4.75 crore again users' data was actually compromised, and it was on sale on the dark web. So these again, this was a report by Cybill, and as usual, Truecaller again denied this particular attack. So it's always good to stay away from such applications which are giving you, although giving you a lot of functionality, but then they are taking a lot of data from you. So if we have any questions, we can take, otherwise I'll just move on to the case studies. How can we disable an app which we are not using and which comes by default with the operating system? So that is a question. Basically, there are a lot of applications which come bundled with most of the Chinese OEMs, and some of these actually you can disable, some of these you can install, but some of these you cannot disable or uninstall. They just simply keep sitting on your device. So in that case, the only thing that you can actually do is, I think there is still a possibility to actually go inside the settings and actually revoke all the dangerous permissions. So anything, if you are not able to do anything, which means if you're not able to uninstall it, if you're not able to disable it, then it's always a good practice, just go and disable all the dangerous permissions which are there. Don't allow it to access your contacts or your locations or anything. But the problem is, a lot of these OEMs actually bundle a lot of system applications inside the device, which actually cannot be uninstalled, which cannot be disabled, and which will not even show you the permissions also, but they actually track the user the usage actually. So they know what all applications are using, and all the information is actually sent to the cloud onto the server wherever of that particular OEM. So the best thing about basically actually is to stay away from all these Chinese manufacturers specifically. That is my personal recommendation, because most of these come with these malicious applications which are already pre-installed, and then they cannot be taken away. The best thing to do is actually to use devices directly from Google and Apple, because then there is no third party involved and you keep getting the security updates directly. But that is not always possible, because normally the devices are a little more expensive. But personally, I would recommend to stay away from Chinese devices. Look for OEMs which are more, regular is issuing these security updates to the devices, so that your phone is updated and it is not part of any attacks. So there are more questions. What are good antivirus software for mobile? So there are several antiviruses available on the Google Play Store, and you can simply go and search for an antivirus and you'll get it. Kaspersky, Bitdefender, and Quick Heal. There are a lot of these. There are a lot of antiviruses available. You can actually just search for. Maybe you can just do a simple Google search. What is the best antivirus for mobile devices? And you'll get a lot of searches, and then you can decide for yourself what is best for you according to the features that they are providing. Are these permissions necessary to design the application by developer? Okay. So I didn't get your question, sir. Can you just elaborate your question while I'll take another one? How do we actually sure whether data leak or breach has actually happened? Because companies would be reluctant to accept such a leakage. Any authority to verify it? So there is no specific authority to verify any data leak. It is always a game of cat and mouse, because sometimes what will happen is that there will be a data breach, and the company, if it is a responsible company, if it is a scrupulous company, it will actually claim that there has been a data breach, and it will automatically start informing the user that all this has happened. But that is something that only responsible companies would do. Otherwise, if a company is not like that, it may just try to hide these claims. But if there are repeatedly claims of data breach on a particular company and they keep denying it, then it is already always suspicious. Otherwise, also in case of Truecaller, like we discussed, if there has been, let us just assume that there has been no data breach on this particular company, but I think through all these lectures and through these sessions, all the participants would have already guessed that there is no secure system which is 100% secure. So if it is not being breached right now, it's possible that it may be breached maybe next year or maybe in 6 months or 2 years down the line. If you're giving it all your information, whenever that thing happens, whenever something like that happens, basically your data is going to be public. So you can assume that all your call logs, your chat history, your SMSs, all your OTPs and everything is going to be public if there is a data breach on a company like that. So it's always a best practice is don't give all these permissions to any application on your device except for the default ones. If you want a service like that, which is given by Truecaller, nowadays even the default Google phone dialer, which is called Phone by Google, that is the name of the application. It is there on Google Play Store. You can simply install that Google dialer application by Google, and then you'll be alerted about spam calls automatically. So you can try that out, because that is the main functionality which Truecaller was serving initially, but now they've expanded and they are like taking a lot of permissions and a lot of user data as well. Free or paid version of antivirus. Okay, just a second. Free or paid version of antivirus for mobile phone. How much may be reasonable for paid version? How much memory requirement may be required for installation of decent antivirus? So, I cannot give you a recommendation or a specific amount of money how much you should pay for it. But I think if you're buying an antivirus for your Windows machine, then in most cases you see that the mobile antivirus actually comes bundled along with it. So you don't normally need to pay for it if you're already buying an antivirus for your Windows machine. But personally, I've never bought an antivirus for my mobile device. So I cannot tell you a reasonable amount of money. If you look at the features, if you know that the company is good and it is giving a lot of protection, then I think some amount of money can actually be paid reasonably. Otherwise, even free antiviruses are pretty good enough if you are not installing any applications from external sources. So in that case, normally it would be good without an antivirus also. The additional thing I think that an antivirus would be providing is that if you're receiving any SMSs or if you're receiving any WhatsApp messages in which there is a malicious link, when you click on that malicious link, I think an antivirus will be able to prevent you from going to the website in the first place. But otherwise, just if you keep a check on the best practices that we talked about today, if you don't visit any website on any random links that you receive on your mobile device, then in most case you should be secure, and even a free antivirus would be enough. How do you rate iOS from other mobile OS? Do they have extra security? So I think iOS, yes, personally, I feel it is a little more secure than the Android side, because the company which is manufacturing the entire device, including the chip, including the hardware, including the motherboard, and including all the sensors and everything, and then that is the same manufacturer which is actually designing the software as well. So it is a closed system. In that sense, it is a little more secure. Whereas if you look at the Android side, then you'll see that software is actually designed by Google, but the hardware actually is designed by different OEMs who are also pushing their own skin on top of the default OS. They are pushing their own applications on top. So that is why I think iOS is a little more secure. And traditionally, iOS, even the place, even the App Store is considered little more secure because they have a lot more security checks in place before any application can actually go onto the Play Store, the App Store. Also, on the iOS side, if you want to be a developer of iOS and if you want to publish an application on the App Store, you actually need to pay some money before you can actually publish your application. On the Android side, it is actually free. So that actually incentivizes a lot of malware attack, I mean, malware developers or attackers to actually create malware and then publish it on the Google Play Store. Although most of these malwares are rejected because now even Google has a lot of security checks before any application can be put up on the Play Store. But still, all these loan applications that I was talking about, they actually have made their way onto the Play Store. And although they are not directly malicious, but then through some tactics, they are able to actually, the developers are actually able to misuse a lot of the information which is available through these applications. So iOS, yes, it is a little more secure. That's my personal thinking, and you can actually decide. Okay, so we are done with all the questions inside the chat box. I'll just move on to the case studies now. And the first case study is about this income tax fraud that is going on, and it has actually been going on for several years. So they become a little more active when the income tax return filing season is going on, which just went away. So people are expecting some refunds into their accounts, and then this is the time when these things actually happen. So you can see these are two screenshots from different SMSs, which these are two like different like you can see the SMSs to different people by their names, which have been sent out, and there is a link by from Bitly, which is a shortened link which has been sent out, and it is saying that you need to click on this particular link to submit a formal request for remittance of your unclaimed approved tax refund of 17,259 rupees. So they actually are able to get databases of users along with their phone numbers, and these databases are actually available. You can actually buy them if you know the right sources, and it's possible that some of you also might have received this kind of an SMS because this was a pretty large-scale campaign which had happened, and SMSs were being sent out to lakhs of people. We had actually been able to find out the SMS gateway itself, which the attackers were using, and we were able to download the SMS logs which had been sent out already. So we were able to find out around 1 lakh or maybe 2 lakh SMSs which were sent out to people for this particular income tax fraud. So you can see that the starting of this particular attack is happening with an SMS, and that's why I've called it SMS phishing or smishing as it is called, which is a link is sent to you via an SMS, and then it leads you to a phishing website, something like this. So briefly, I talked about this yesterday also. You can see the name of the website is Income Tax Department. And although the on top you can see that the URL is different, it is unipsomething.com and then some random folders. So that's why you can see that this particular page is actually not the genuine Income Tax Department's website. It is actually fake. And if you click on that particular drop-down menu, you will actually be shown options for different bank accounts. And once you select your bank account, you will actually be taken to your bank account's net banking page, which if it is Citibank, it will look like this. But if it is State Bank of India, you will have the State Bank of India's page, and similarly for all the other banks. Then the first thing that you need to do obviously is to give your net banking username and password. And once you click on that login button, and okay, before we go on to the next slide, you just notice the URL which is there in the address bar. It is some random IP address and then some random folders are there after that. So this is not the Citibank's page. And when you click on the login button, you will actually be taken to this next page where if you can read, you can see that they are asking you for your PAN card, your full name, your address, PIN code, mobile number, marital status, your gender, sex, and date of birth, your email address, account number, Aadhaar number, credit card, debit card, CVV, ATM, basically all your private details of all your financial details. So they are taking all these details, and once you click on the submit button, you will be taken to this particular page. It will show you that your income tax refund application is incomplete, and you must verify your mobile device in order to get the refund. So they will give you a link. They will send you an SMS in some cases, and sometimes an APK file will be directly downloaded onto your device. And you can see at the bottom they have given the instructions for installing this particular application also. So it is saying go to settings, go to security or lock screen and security, and then scroll down and check unknown sources. So they are giving you instruction on how to enable installation from unknown sources. And once you have enabled that, only then this particular application can be installed. So they are saying that you need to install this APK. Once you have installed this particular APK on your device, I'll just show you the screenshot, and then I'll go back to the previous slides and talk about that. So you can see over here the icon is here in the first screenshot. You can see it is e_mobile and it has the logo of the income tax department. And then the next one is it is asking you for becoming the default SMS application, which means whenever an SMS is arriving and you are getting a notification, basically you will be coming into this application instead of the default SMS application. And in the last screenshot, you can see that it is asking you for access to contacts. So similarly, it was actually asking for your contacts, your, I think, even your call logs. We look at the next slide where I have actually listed all the permissions. So we were actually able to find out these APK files and the related files by taking a website dump of the attacker's website that he had deployed, and then we were able to recover this APK. And we did the analysis on this particular application by reverse engineering the code, and these are the things that we found out eventually, that this application is basically being installed on the device to snoop your OTP messages. So the attacker already has your debit card, your credit card, your net banking credentials, but if he needs to actually execute an attack, or if he actually needs to do some transaction, then he basically needs the OTP which you are receiving on your mobile device. So that is what is happening. Once you install this particular application on your device, all your SMSs actually are forwarded to the attacker's phone number, and you never even get to know when an SMS is actually arriving on your device, because it is deleted from your device directly. So that is what happens over here, and we've already looked at these screenshots, and I'll just give you an overview of the code that was there inside the application. So you can see there are three permissions which it is asking: read phone state, send SMS, get accounts. So these are the permissions that the application was actually asking for. And then this is another snippet from the code. You can see that these blacked out sections actually are phone numbers of actually from India itself. You can see the code is +91 and then there is a 10-digit number. So if you read the code a little bit, you'll see it is SMS manager dot send text message. So what is happening is basically the attacker is segregating the different kinds of SMSs that are being received on the mobile device, and depending on the category, they are actually forwarding it onto different phone numbers which actually belong to the attackers themselves. So if it is an OTP message, for example, they might be sending it to a particular number. If it is an informational SMS, it might be sent to a different number. So we don't know exactly what was there, but they were doing this segregation, and then there were four separate phone numbers which they were sending them onto. So that is the first case study that happened. And so what we learned from this case study is basically if you are getting any links inside your SMS or your WhatsApp, ideally you should not be clicking on those links. This I think we have already drilled down a lot already in the previous session as well. But especially in this one, you should make sure that on your mobile device, you should not go to any such website, or you should not open these links. If you even want to open them, then always try to open them inside your laptop or your desktop machine, because then you can at least see the link which is there inside the URL bar. And the other thing is that your laptop or machine you can open incognito mode, and you can try to open it even if you really want to open these links. Because your mobile device actually carries a lot of your personal communication and information which your laptop or your desktop would not be having. So your contacts, your location history, and your SMSs with the OTPs and everything, they are housed inside your mobile device, and you should always take care that at least this particular device should always be 100% secure as far as possible. Then moving on to the second case study. This actually happened on, again, I have categorized it as SM smishing, but these links were actually being forwarded via random WhatsApp numbers. And you can see that it is mentioning your 130,000 low interest loan. So I was talking about these loan applications that have been going on nowadays. And it was all over the newspapers and the news as well, that several people have actually committed suicide due to these applications and all. But this is actually from some time back. These have actually come onto the forefront now, and they have been reported in the news now. But such loan applications, actually, we found out about these, I think, way back in September or maybe October, and we had actually sent out a report regarding this. Although this was not a large-scale attack, because we had not received a lot of reports regarding this, but now it has kind of become a huge attack, because these applications have actually started appearing on the Play Store. Earlier, these applications were actually hosted on fake domains like this. You can see coinlke.com. This is the name of the website, and then there is this particular page which is giving you a link to Google Play Store. So it is saying that get it on Google Play Store, but actually an APK file will be downloaded of this particular application called Oppo Rupee, and this is again that same kind of application. So when you click on that link, you'll be taken to this page. When you click on this download button, it will actually download an application on your device. And once you open that application, you'll see that it is asking for permission to the camera. So a loan application is asking for permission to the camera. Ideally, it should not be requiring that. So you know it is a red flag in the first place. And then it asks for your mobile number. And I think even without the OTP, when I tried to sign in, it was signing in. So it was pure malicious attempt, pure malicious intent in this case, because you are giving away your mobile number, and you are actually giving away your contacts and your camera permissions as well. So they will be able to make camera recordings of you, and they will be able to get some personal information about you. Then when you need to set a password and all, and then you will be taken to the next screen, which will actually give you option to get a loan for like 5,000, 10,000, very small amount of loan. And then you need to actually pay some amount of money in order to get that. So that's what they were doing in this particular case. So I listed all the permissions that these particular applications were taking. You can see that it is actually taking permission to the camera and to read the logs, to read the contacts, to write settings permission. If you can see, the last one is actually write settings, and it is actually getting access to your storage as well, to read your basically to read your files and your pictures and everything. So all these permissions this particular application was taking, and similarly there were other similar applications like that. So what we have heard lately is that they actually give you a loan of a particular amount that you are saying, and they have a very, very steep rate of interest. So in like 15 days, if you're taking a loan of 2000 rupees for 15 days, on the 15th day, they'll call you and say that you need to pay 4000 or 4500 rupees. And then you, when you argue with them, they'll start calling all your contacts, and then they'll start basically defaming you, and then they'll say that this person has actually taken a loan. So what I think is that these applications were primarily targeted on the teenagers who actually require, you know, for various things, they might need some small loan which for doing things. And what happens is that once the 15 day period or the 30 day period is over, they start calling up their parents, and then they start threatening them. So we've heard that people have actually committed suicide because of these things. So again, staying away from applications or from external sources, and not clicking on any links which you have received in SMSs or random WhatsApp messages. And that is the end of the presentation. Our email ID is again mentioned. You can actually, if you receive any such SMSs or any such applications which you come across, then you can send it to us, and we'll take a look at them. Again, I'll just go through the chat box and see if there are any questions. Please give some example of signature permissions. So I don't remember any signature permissions as such, but you can just go through your basically your settings page. You can go through your applications. If you have a device of any Chinese manufacturers like Redmi or Xiaomi or something like that, then the default applications which are installed by the OEM always have some signature permission inside them. So the default permission, when you look at them, it will look like com.android.something, but if you look at these signature permissions, it will be com.xiaomi.something. If you see that kind of a permission over there, it is basically a signature permission. So someone has said that my question was inside the Q&A section. So I'll just see if I can open the Q&A section. Yeah, I can actually open it. So is there any way to disagree with the terms of the app? And so can we bypass them always? So normal, on a normal mobile, I don't think there is a way to actually disagree with the terms and conditions. You will have to agree to proceed, but otherwise, if you try to hack the application, there are some ways by which you can actually install it on an emulator and then go about it. But in that case, it will not, I don't think it will function, because most of the applications nowadays have anti-VM techniques, and I think it requires a fair bit of technical expertise to actually bypass all these checks and still use the application. So if you do not agree to the terms and conditions of an application, then it's always just best to not use the application. That is my recommendation. How to know if there are such doubtful apps and avoid installing on a device? Who intimates about such potential problems in advance? So there is no way to actually avoid installing any malicious application on your device. The best thing is just look at the functionality of the application, and then look at the permissions which it is seeking. If you are doubtful, then don't install it. And again, if you have any applications on your device which you're not using on a regular basis, like even on a weekly basis, you're not using any application, then I would recommend that you just uninstall it. For example, even Amazon, Flipkart, and all these applications, even if you're not shopping, they actually stay on your device, and most users don't uninstall them. But I still recommend that you should not keep even these applications on your device. You can simply go to the Play Store and install them once more, because internet is almost free nowadays, so it's not such a big problem. You can just go and install that application again. So stay away from most of these applications. Is there any way to clean the system as permission remains valid even after uninstall a particular application? So no, sir, the permission actually does not remain valid even after you uninstall a particular application. Once you have uninstalled a particular application, ideally it is going away, unless there was some embedded malware inside it which it has been able to drop on your system, then that is possible. But if you are staying away from most of these untrusted sources and you are not installing APKs, in most cases that you won't be facing that issue. And then there is a question, Telegram seeks permission to access user's gallery prior to allowing download of a video or audio. Is it safe to allow it? Otherwise, it is not possible to download them. So, definitely, if you're trying to download a particular file from Telegram or from any other application, it actually needs access to write on your storage. So, if you want to download something, you will actually have to give it that permission. But otherwise, Telegram, I think, is pretty good in the sense that that you actually can disable all the permissions and you can still use the application at least. It will not say that you cannot use the application. So you can actually not give it your contacts. You cannot basically disallow the access to your storage and everything, and still the application would work. So that is a good thing about Telegram. But if you want to download something, then definitely you need to give it the permission. Okay, so then I think there are a few more questions inside the chat box. I'll just go through them. From the data breach perspective, how effective is the second layering in apps where we can hide some data using hide feature in that application? Okay, so how effective is the second layering in application where we can hide some data, hide feature in that app? So hide feature, even if you are hiding it, basically it is not visible directly, like if you are using the mobile device. But I think if somebody can actually connect your mobile device to a computer, and if they can actually look at the storage, then in that case I think all the hidden contents are also visible. And if you take a forensic image, for example, I think all the contents would be visible. So the hiding is like only from the UI. It is not like actually hiding it. And also a lot of these applications which say that they are hiding the stuff, and they also take a lot of permissions. So you should always be cautious about using even such applications, because I remember a lot of these vault applications and file hide applications are actually blocked by the government because they were taking a lot of data to Chinese servers. So I would suggest stay away from such applications as well. Then there is a question, best way to remove doubtful application because after uninstall the application permission remains. I think we have already discussed this. Is there any app or site where we can check that particular app is malicious or threat to security? Okay, so I don't think there is any website apart from VirusTotal. So there is a website called virustotal.com. You can go to that particular website, and if there is an APK file, you can submit it. Similarly, there are other such online sandboxes which are available. You can go and submit APK files if you are receiving. But ideally, you should not do that if it is a targeted attack on you, if somebody is trying to attack you. Instead of sending it to VirusTotal, which is a private company and it is not even hosted in India. So ideally, you should, if you are having any doubt that someone has attacked you or you have received some such application, you should actually send it to Certain, and we will analyze the application and then we'll see what can be done about it. But I didn't have a website to directly tell you whether an application is malicious. If you are installing from the App Store or Play Store, normally it should not be malicious. Okay, so I think we are done with the questions. There is one more question. Why don't these departments like income tax have registered mobile number for sending communication to people at Pan India level? What we generally see is a message from VK IT department. People won't be tricked into such scams if they know the registered numbers already. So, sir, actually, that is like a policy level change, and I think we have already communicated this to the Department of Telecommunications, which basically handles this entire infrastructure of SMSs and bulk SMSs. So we have already flagged this particular issue to them. I think they are already taking care of this thing. Any method to block an ad in an application or mobile? I don't think there is a method to block advertisements unless if there are ad blocker applications available for mobile, just like browsers, but I have personally not used any of them. So I don't know. And I think we are done with the questions. Mehdi, I think we are good to go. And
one more question, sir, in the chat bar from the show. I am getting about approved loan. But
okay.
The credit side, I think even the message is sufficient.
Sir, I was not able to hear you. Where is this actually? Where is this?
In the chat box. Chat box.
In the chat box, okay. Okay, so I'm not able to find out. Sir, can you just read it out? I was not able to hear you last time.
I am getting about approved loan. But safer
okay.
Side. Delete the message sufficient.
Yeah, if you are receiving such SMSs, then if you don't click on that links, then definitely you would not be landing into any trouble. So even if you don't delete that message, even if it is sitting on your device, that is okay. But ideally, to avoid any unintentional clicks on that link or anything, then it's always a good practice. If you are not going to that link, then just delete that SMS and that should be okay. So somewhere, sometime you might have shared your phone number with some, while getting a credit card or while getting something, somewhere we do share our phone numbers. And that is why we talked about maintaining multiple online identities yesterday. So if you are using a particular phone number for giving it to banks and all, then for your personal communication and for other stuff, you should not be using that particular phone number. You should totally avoid using that particular phone number. So if you maintain two separate phone numbers for different purposes, in that case, you would normally be more secure. And ideally, most of us have actually received these fake SMSs for loans or for credit cards or for something of this sort. So always just don't click on those links, and I think you should mostly be safe. Naresh ji, I think we are done with the questions.
Sir, thank you very much for the presentation. Now, dear participant, we'll take a break for 5 minutes and we'll meet at 11 o'clock. Thank you.
Okay, thank you to all
thank
the participants
sir.
For attending, and the questions were really good, and I think using because of these questions a lot of doubts would be cleared. So thank you for being an attentive and responsive audience, and see you soon.
Yeah, dear participants, welcome back to the session after a small break. And today we are going to cover the yesterday session only, continuation to the yesterday session. The public key algorithms. The other details. So we are just starting the session.